You know, Gar, they say that when you wish upon a star, your dreams come true. If by chance your dream is to listen to a new episode of Magic by Design, whether you're an old friend of the show or listening for the first time, thanks so much for tuning in. We are delighted to have you on board. My name is Ken, and I am joined, as always, by my co-host slash brother, Garrett. Gar, how are you?
If your dream is to wish for me talking about a Disney thing, I'm sorry. Please dream bigger, I'm sorry. Please? There are many things you can dream for, Ken. And me talking about Home on the Range is certainly not on the list of things anybody should dream for. Because that would mean they'd have to engage with Home on the Range, and that's really an unfortunate thing to do. But here we are doing it.
Gary, you mentioned it. We are farming for takes on Disney's 45th animated feature, Home on the Range, this week, first released in 2004.
It's a bad movie.
Okay, job done. You can listen to new episodes. We do that bit far too often.
Yeah, because I blurt out my overall take on the film, and then you're like, well, we might as well end the podcast. And that's one of our standard formulas. It feels very pretentious to say, and very artsy, and almost like, you know, co-opted by the company to say, but this isn't a Disney movie. It doesn't feel like a Disney movie. It doesn't have any of the components. Actually, no, the only component element it has that feels even remotely like a Disney movie is the music, because the music is done by Alan Menken, and it would be an utter disaster for him. Like, it would really take a calamity for him not to produce at least something slightly entertaining when it comes to the music side of things. But this is just a film that's got nothing going on.
I think we were like 15 minutes, not even, into it before we said, we both looked at each other and like had the exact same thought, which you just vocalized. This is not Disney.
It's just not. And like, there's a moment at the start of this film where Maggie walks up the farm and it's like, dur, 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 and just like, no. Just no, yeah. That's not what these films are.
I remember you going, oh no.
Yeah, and like, that's what I really commend the Disney animated features for not being at any stage. Even at the lows of Aristocats, even at the lows of Fantasia 2000 and Dinosaur, and films that I really don't like, they're not this. They're not that, like, lowest common denominator, just shallow,
cynical children's entertainment.
Yeah, we focus tested this to death, and the kids laughed at the colors, and the pigs going, awesome! Which I feel like there is children characters that say awesome in all of these cynical, shameless films. And that's just not Disney.
The kids love Roseanne Barr.
In the pantheon of Beauty and the Beast and Bambi and The Lion King and Lilo and Stitch, and they all have to sit right here next to Home on the Range.
It's not even just the lazy plotting. It doesn't even look like a Disney film.
It's generic. It's just cows. And fair enough, like, what can you do to spruce up, like, an Old West cow film? There's really not that much. It's just going to be a lot of browns and cliffs. And that's what this film is. It's a lot of browns and cliffs. There's nothing in this film except for, like, some okay music. Not even good music. It's not even like, I'll be singing the songs from this movie for the end of time. It's not like a Pocahontas, which is a film I don't particularly love, but Colors of the Wind is just an all-time banger. It doesn't even have anything like that. It's just, there is nothing in this. And I don't even want to go so far as to say this film is offensively bad, because it's not.
It's offensively fine.
It's just nothing. It's just nothing. It just exists. It was made cynically to make money, and that's what it did. It was a modest financial success. Well, no, not really.
No. I'll get into it later.
It wasn't a Treasure Planet level flop, though. It did make its production budget back, which Treasure Planet didn't. So it wasn't like a colossal failure, but it's just an empty, soulless, corporate-driven nothing with no good performances, no memorable plot, no good animation, and some passably mediocre songs. That's what this movie is, and that's all this movie was trying to be, which is the really bad part.
The thing that makes me sad, and the overwhelming feeling I got from this film, was Disney went from being the leaders in the industry to chasing what was working with other studios. Like, I got a very distinctive DreamWorks feel from this movie.
There's even a shot at DreamWorks in it, which is actually the only good thing about the film, that they look at another horse and it's like more like Stallion of Cimarron. Yeah. And I'm like, actually, that's a good line. Well done.
It's a good line, but also a funny shot at DreamWorks.
But like, the problem is, they put that line into a film in which they're aping DreamWorks. DreamWorks style. So who are the morons here?
Exactly.
Disney are, Ken. Disney are the moron. And the most frustrating part is, like, we're now, like, 5-6 films removed from Tarzan. Removed from, like, what's considered the end of the Renaissance. And I like a lot of the films in that intervening period. Like, Emperor's New Groove, people like it. I don't. But I can see why people like it. Treasure Planet and Atlantis, both very enjoyable adventure films. Brother Bear, a lovely film that I don't love. And Lilo and Stitch, a lovely film that I do love. Those are all, like, good to great films, one of which is the best film of all time up there. And then you get this. You get Home on the Range. You get this soulless corporate drivel just mucked out, where there's cows making fart noises, catchphrases from children's characters, people mugging to the camera, no good jokes, no good story, no good writing, nothing that'll make you feel anything. It's cynical, bottom of the barrel, lowest common denominator entertainment that has to sit in the pantheon of Snow White and Beauty and the Beast and Bambi and The Lion King and The Little Mermaid and all of these films that, like, even when there's an element of cynicism in all of them, don't get me wrong, Disney is a corporation aiming to make money. They're naked. There's nothing. Fantasia is probably the only thing they made that's like, let's make a thing we think is cool that we'll desperately try and then to make it commercially viable. Everything else, it's like, we're making money here, folks. But this, it's not even like, why don't we make something good while it happens? And this is the kind of film I always push back on. I've said it like 7 times on this podcast. The children's entertainment does not have to be this. The children's entertainment can be Lilo and Stitch. It can be Beauty and the Beast. It can appeal to things children like while raising the level of things they should like, not stooping to just bright colours and loud noises. And this film is just bright colours. It's not even bright colours. It's browns all over the place because it's freaking Wild West and whatever. So it's just browns and loud noises. You don't even get bright colours. Beige and brown everywhere. Ugh.
It won't surprise you that there's not a lot of information on this film online, and a lot of people forget that it even exists. And as you said, it feels a shame that it shares the same DNA or has to go in the canon of those previous films.
I'm looking at the Home on the Range Wikipedia page.
Yes.
In which I see the poster.
Oh, I had a note on that, yeah.
Bust a Moo.
Yeah. That is...
That's like...
That's proof, if you needed it, that they were trying to mimic DreamWorks after the success of Shrek.
They have distilled everything wrong with this film down to a single slogan on the poster. Bust a Moo. Just get it, it's bust a Moo, because that's trendy, but Moo is a cow pun.
Previous to this, everything had a sense of earnestness to it, even if it wasn't successful, you know? They were trying for something deeper. They were trying to make something that was art and have storylines that at least evoked a reaction, as you said, or made you think. Where this, it just seemed like they were trying to slap something out there to make a buck.
Yeah.
Like, kids don't mind. They'll watch anything.
But, like, why did they do this? I get, like, Treasure Planet was a giant flop. Like, a giant flop. But Lilo and Stitch was a mild success. Brother Bear even was a... Like, Lilo and Stitch was a big success, really.
Brother Bear did okay.
Yeah, Brother Bear did okay. And, like, why did they do this? Well, like, what world did they think that aping what DreamWorks was doing was the solution to, like, some of their woes? Instead of, like... Because they haven't been making films with the hit rate that they did in the 90s. Where they rolled out, like, Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Lion King, all these films back to back to back, Hercules, Tarzan, all of them, one after another, beloved hits, made tons of money, and are still, like, celebrated to this day. Like, they certainly weren't doing that in the 2000s. Since the very start of the 2000s, the second they released Fantasia and Dinosaur. There is obviously a decline in quality, and there's obviously a decline in, like, the cultural cash the films from that era hold, the only one of which really is relevant is Lilo and Stitch, the rest of which have kind of just faded to time. So, like, where did they think the solution here was not to do what they did well again, but rather what DreamWorks was doing quote-unquote well at the time?
I think maybe it got in their head when Shrek won the Best Animated Feature for the first, you know, the first award.
Mm.
And I think that, you know, there was kind of a fear that they were being left behind. So when that happens, there can be an urge to say, well, if this is what the audiences want, maybe we should give it to them.
But on the flip side of that, you might have had DreamWorks, but what else did you have during that era, Ken?
Pixar.
And what did Pixar pretty much exclusively do during that era?
Churn out hits.
Not even hits, but turned out the kind of films that, like, are just the polar opposite of what DreamWorks are making.
Like, the Pixar always tried to make art aimed at children, and DreamWorks tried to make commercial entertainment aimed at children. It just happened to be art. But, like, when was this film? 04?
Yes.
So, like, same year as The Incredibles, year before was Finding Nemo. Like, year before that, 2 years before that was Monsters, Inc. So it's like, even Cars, which I think is the most cynical of the Pixar films, wasn't released for another 2 years. I don't know. I just don't get why they're like, let's make a DreamWorks film.
Yeah, I think there's animation as an art form and animation as kids entertainment, and you know, I think there was a cynicism that crept in the early 2000s and throughout the end of the decade as well. It picked up, but also it's worth noting here, this film was in development for a long time. You may remember from our Pocahontas episode that Disney director Mike Gabriel considered adapting Western legends such as Annie Oakley, Buffalo Bill, and Pecos Bill. And you might remember Pecos Bill as a segment from, I can't remember, it's one of the package films.
Make My Music.
Yeah. It's one of those anyway.
So Ludo's Amigos. I actually think it might be in one of them.
No.
No, it's not in those.
It's not
Make Fun My and Music. Fancy Free.
I think it's, no, not that either. There's not that many left. Melody Time?
It might be Melody Time.
Yeah.
We've named all of them now, so it has to be one of them.
If you go back and listen to whatever episode we talked about that in, we buried Pecos Bill because it's real bad. So this film is inspired by those kind of stories, but when he pitched the Wild West projects, the executives at Disney preferred Pocahontas, which went into production first. When Pocahontas was finished, Gabriel went back to his Western pitch and came up with the idea that would combine Captain's Courage with a Western. I don't know what Captain's Courage is. Should have looked that up for the podcast.
Live Googling.
Gabriel then developed his concept into a 40-page treatment, which was well received by then feature animation president Peter Schneider.
I assume you meant Captain's Courageous.
Yeah, that.
Which is apparently a 1937 film based on the Rudyard Kipling novel that had some people in them. There you go. Mickey Rooney was in it. Sure. Okay.
R.I.P. Soon after, the project titled Sweating Bullets went into development. The story originated as a supernatural western about a timid cowboy who visits a ghost town and confronts an undead cattle hustler named Slim. It was later reconceived into a story about a literal bull named Bullets that wanted to be more like horses that led the herd. This is a long history.
Both of those, by the way, sound much more interesting than the cow film they actually ended up making.
Yeah.
Like, the ghost one actually sounds pretty cool.
It's like Ghostbusters, except a cartoon. In 1999, in an attempt to salvage the production and retain the existing characters and background art, story artist Michael Labash suggested a different approach to the story, and one that involved three cow protagonists who would become bounty hunters to save their farm.
That actually, like, it may kind of make sense that they're just like, we have these assets from this like, we tried to make this three times. And we
it's
have
not working out.
We have these like hodgepodge pieces together. Let's just see what we can make from them and get it out the door, which feels kind of like how it ended up being.
And if we're talking about sticking to what brought them to the dance, anthropomorphic animals is their jam. Mm. So I can see why they went in that direction. It's as like, well,
we haven't done cows before. Let's just do cows.
Mike Gabriel left the project in 2000, and he with his partner, Mike Giamo, went to make The Road to El Dorado for DreamWorks. They came back afterwards. Critics were fairly kind to Home on the Range, acknowledging it as a funny, colourful, and action-packed adventure for kids, while acknowledging that it's one of the more middling efforts from the Disney studio. Home on the Range was released in April 2004, grossing about $145.5 million. That's $201.5 million in 2021 money.
I have a bone to pick one of the critics, by the way. Classic me picking on people who reviewed a film.
Allow me to finish, and I will let you have your rant, as all usual. Right. Against a budget of $110 million, that's $152 million in 2021, it was a financial flop when you factor in the marketing. Following the box office disappointment, financial analysts predicted that Disney would be forced to write down the production costs, which totaled more than $100 million.
Claudia Puig? Of USA Today wrote favorably in her review that Home on the Range is a throwback to old Disney cartoons, fun rather than message-laden, with broad humor and entertaining action. What Disney films did she watch?
I think she's referring to the shorts.
Really?
Because the shorts had that kind of, I suppose...
Because, like, this is 2004, Ken. So, yeah. Like, the old Disney cartoons might mean Bambi, it might mean The Lion King, and it might mean, like, as you said, Steamboat Willie. So, like... What? It's the, like, slapstick? She wants full slapstick?
Yeah, I think what she's looking for is Looney Tunes.
Yeah, different thing there. But, like, Bambi is, like, fully a film about environmentalism. So, like,
it's borderline a drama.
Yeah. So let's not pretend like Disney, like, oh, back in the good old days of the Disney studio when, you know, Bambi, which was film number 5 or whatever, that they were making these soulless, dumb, stupid films that are broad and colorful, and that's all we want out of children's entertainment, instead of something like Lilo and Stitch, which is like a really deep piece of work that allows people to work through grief and has something meaningful to say for children that they can connect to while also having the things children like. I hate it. I hate that so much.
And you could argue that the visuals in Lilo and Stitch are low key, but they harmonize with the environment of Hawaii, and
it's a much nicer looking movie.
Yeah, it's an aesthetic choice. It's not just, oh, let's just do this because we want to have colors for kids.
And we tried to do a Western film twice. It didn't work, but we're just going to put the cows in the Western film and hope for the best. Like, that's why this film ended up the way it was.
Like, we mentioned Looney Tunes there. Like, the visuals, including the backgrounds, very much spoke Looney Tunes to me. And it feels more like TV animation than a feature.
We've had a big Looney Tunes controversy I think we have to bring up now this weekend.
Of course.
Lola Bunny isn't as sexy anymore.
Yeah, her boobs shrank.
Cancel culture has come for Lola Bunny. I tweeted this yesterday, but I should really just pivot to being a right-wing grifter. It seems so easy.
Yeah, you just whip people up by going, we can't even have bunny boobs anymore.
Yeah, it's like the liberals want to take away your bunny boobs. Can't have bunny boobs anymore.
Hashtag bunny boobs.
And that, there you go. You can just be angry about it on YouTube for 15 minutes and you'll get recommended to half the planet and money. It seems so easy. God. What do you think of all the Space Jam 2 stuff? The plot is just the stupidest thing I've ever seen in my life.
It just seems like really, not even convoluted, but like this film, by the numbers, what would kids like? Video games? And then there's like...
The internet. They go into the internet and find films like The Matrix, which is like Ready Player One.
And then like the villain is like an algorithm, but he's also like a spoiled billionaire or something like that.
And let's not pretend like the plot of the original Space Jam was like grounded. Like, it was an alien amusement park owner wanted an attraction for his flagging amusement park. So he stole the talent of basketballs and gave it to his weird basketball players, even not basketballs. I don't think inanimate objects have much talent. He stole the talent of basketball players to give to his aliens so that they would become a marquee attraction for his alien theme park. But the plot of the frickin' Space Jam 2 does make that look grounded.
But the thing is, they don't labor over it in Space Jam. Like, you have the setup, he wants to have the Looney Tunes for his theme park, then they steal the talent of the basketball players. They, in response, kidnap, basically, Michael Jordan. And before you know it, it's only like 35 minutes into the film, we're at the game.
Yeah.
So, like, it just moves along quickly, and, like, it's all used for set dressing. You know, just to have Michael Jordan play basketball with the Looney Tunes. That's what we want to see at the end of the day. Where this is just, like, trying to, maybe, I don't know what the world is, like, world build. And it's just...
But, yeah, again, I think you're right in that it's just, like, kids like the internet, they like video games, they like basketball. Let's shove it all together. Apparently they're going to visit like the Matrix and Mad Max while they're in the Tron. It's basically Tron. It's more Tron than it is Space Jam.
Let's promote our other properties while we're at it.
Yeah, so it's even more cynical when you think about it that way. It's like a HBO Max tour. And then
further bone to pick, they clearly struck a deal with Nike for the jerseys, which are also horrible.
Yeah, and then they have 3D. It's 3D animated instead of 2D, which
apparently it's a mixture of the two. Mm. I think it's 2D before they go into the computer game, and then 3D after.
Do 2D the first time.
Is it Ryan Coogler attached to this?
Is he? I've no idea.
Also,
probably just the producer and taking a paycheck.
Yeah, just call it Space Jam 2. It's called Space Jam: A New Legacy. I'm like, nah, it's hand stupid. Wave.
But yes,
they'll get my money.
They will. Actually, HBO Max isn't available here. That might be by the time it releases. Might be released in theaters here.
July. Yeah, I think we might be okay. So because, well, I've said that many times this year. I'm being wrong.
We were like, maybe we'll be able to see Raya and the whatever they're called, the dragon film, where we decided not to watch until the first viewing on a podcast that came out this week. It's a big Disney release this week.
Yeah, we're holding off until the podcast episode comes up.
So we won't actually watch it until we cover it on the podcast. But yeah,
going back,
Space Jam 2, bad.
Going back to this film.
Space Jam 1 is bad, let's not deny it. But good, bad. Sorry,
don't derail the podcast any further. You're going to make me mad. We have to go back.
What do you think about Space?
we have to go back to Home on the Range, Gar. Well, the one thing
we have to.
We do have to, I'm afraid. We promised we would, and we're in the midst of it. One thing that really bothered me, the character animation and expressions are extremely reminiscent of the DreamWorks style of time rather than the Disney House style that we were used to in past features. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, the expressions and the
making dopey faces. Let's not pretend like, you know, people have big googly eyes back in all the Disney films, and Simba is the same. But Simba feels like a character, not just a walking...
It's that trope of the raised eyebrow and the sassy faces. And...
It's bad. It's bad, Ken!
It's real bad. Also, there's a lot of wholly unnecessary 3D in this film, so it's a very flat 2D film with some very weird, jarring 3D, especially the empty inside of Pearl's house while she reminisces about her stolen cows.
And it's just like, for like, you know, 3 seconds, that house is 3D before it goes back to 2D. I'm like, why? And they're doing a car chase at the end, and they go into like a first-person 3D perspective, and it looks terrible. And it's just
yeah,
like,
but actually, when they show it as 2D, it's quite fun. The 3D is just off-putting.
Yeah, and it's like, why did you put this in here? What are you doing? And again, this was the same year that The Incredibles was released, which is a very good looking film. We were watching a little bit of Ratatouille last night, just a brief glimpse of it, which was released 2 years later, and also a very good looking film. No wonder they bought Pixar 2 years after this, because like, they're just like, Pixar, can you do this 3D stuff for us?
Yeah, and they were knocking out of the park time after time at this stage, you know. So I think basically they lost their mojo and
hired it back with Pixar.
Yeah, because John Lasseter became, well, you know, obviously he's cancelled now, but he became
head of animation.
Yeah,
and then head of Disney as a whole in the end, didn't he?
Yeah, Pixar and Disney. That's when their what I call new Renaissance period starts, which we'll have at the end of this decade. So
they really bought it back when you think about it.
They bought their mojo back. Yeah. Moving on to the story, Gar. This film is tainted as soon as you hear the voice of Roseanne Barr.
Nah.
And she belches and you're like, we know what we're in for here, girl.
Yeah, it's the one she's like burping and the kids laughed at her, and I'm like, Judi Dench, why would you attach yourself to this?
Yeah, I wrote that down in one of my notes, that Judi Dench agreed to do this film for some reason.
Dame Judy, why have you sullied yourself with this?
She probably had grandkids. She's like, oh, maybe this is something the grandkids can watch. That's what they say.
It's probably like, you know, it's like, oh, yeah, like Angela Lansbury. She's people loved her in Beauty and the Beast. Sure, I'll do one of these Disney films. Like,
do it for the grandkids.
Oh, no.
In fairness, it's not a bad paycheck either.
What have I signed myself up for?
She thought it would stand the test of time like Beauty and the Beast, but it didn't. She also has a weird thing about her hat, which is kind
of
dumb.
I don't like any of these. Like Maggie, Mrs. Calloway, and Grace. I just don't like them. I don't like any of them.
Grace voiced by Jennifer Tilly.
I don't know who Jennifer Tilly is.
She's kind of like a femme fatale type that was in 90s movies.
She was in Child's Play.
Yes, she was.
She was in...
Chucky's Wife.
That seems to be about it. She was in a lot of films I've never heard of. Apparently she was in Monsters, Inc.
Gerd, there's a very heavy joke density in this film, but hardly any of them land. It's just all cynical, cheap toilet humor.
There's... I didn't laugh once. No, I laughed once. I laughed at the stallion
Cimarron
line, which is, again, quite funny. And the rest of the film is terrible.
There couldn't be more lazy plotting. It's the old race against time to raise money to save the farm trope. And there is a reward for capturing the cattle poacher Almeida Slim, which is coincidentally the exact same amount of money they need to save the farm.
Shock. I'm fine with that. But like, I don't care about Buck as a character. I don't care about Slim as a villain. And like,
although it's pretty badass that he rides a buffalo.
That's pretty cool. But like, the big thing, there's a big twist in this film where like the bounty hunter and Buck's idol Rico is actually a bad guy all along, and I'm like, when that's revealed, I'm just like,
it's extremely obvious that he was on the take the entire time.
But I'm just like, I don't care. Like, I just don't care about this character, both Rico and Buck. And like, I just don't like anybody in this film. There's not a single character that I'm like, I can at least attach myself to this aspect of this film.
Do you know, I thought Buck was ripping off the zebra from Madagascar, but this film came out before that.
So there you go.
You noted Alameda Slim there. He has some pretty fun songs. And
does he?
Like, he does that yodel song.
I don't care about that either. I don't care about any of this film, Ken.
It's weird. He actually looks like a Looney Tunes villain as well.
Maybe he does. Maybe this is just secretly a Warner Brothers film. Maybe they snuck it in there. Maybe Disney just published it and we never knew any. No one was ever the wiser.
Yeah.
Bust a moo. Every time I see that poster, sorry, Ken, it just upsets me every time.
Yeah. It's just like, you don't see that on Disney posters. You think back to all the beautiful hand-painted posters of the past.
Or even like the Lilo and Stitch poster, which is this really cool idea that like he's this outcast that... every Disney family or every family has one. And then there is Bust a Moo, which is just so deeply cynical. This film is so short as well, and it doesn't feel like it.
It's scarcely over 70 minutes, but somehow feels longer.
It's It has a 76-minute runtime according to Wikipedia, and it just, I zoned out for a long stretch. I'm not going to do that. I zoned out for a long stretch of this movie.
There was the bit where they were trying to escape the flood. I zoned out for quite a lot of that.
Yeah.
And the bit where they were going through the mine on the roller coaster.
That's the deep analysis people come to Magic by Design for, to be like, I just tuned this film out. But like,
and we said earlier, Gar, we had a walk earlier before the pod, and we tried to talk about this film, but I couldn't remember most of it.
Like when you said, because you want to record the podcast a day early so you can edit it, and you're like, I'm like, yeah, sure. It's like, oh yeah, we're talking Home on the Range. I'm like, oh yeah, we watched that yesterday, because this film is just so forgettable. There's nothing. That's the reason I'm saying, basically, I can't even see what, we're half hour into this podcast, give or take.
Yeah, we're running out of steam already.
I just have nothing to say about it. There's nothing there. It's just an empty film that's boring, and you'll tune it out. And it's a film that, like, as I said, maybe it would have been good last week when you were like, oh, Home on the Range. I'm like, no, I'll give it a chance.
Don't prejudge it, Ken. I warned you, Gar. I warned you.
But the second, like, Maggie was walking down that thing, and they were playing the nerner knockoff, and I was just like, no. Just no.
You knew then what you were in for.
The second they did that, and then, like, she's making fart jokes, and I'm just like, oh, this is where we're, this is the bottom, I think, Ken. This is like, this really is the bottom. Because, like, as we said, a lot of the films in this post-Renaissance period are good and deserve more love than they get. And this deserves every bit of scorn it gets.
This is like below the bottom of the barrel.
Mm.
And Gar, we'll sum up later, but I think this could be in dead last place, Gar.
It's down there with Aristocats.
The package films as well.
Even the package films have like at least like 4 minutes of which I'm like, oh yeah, that's a nice little short. This has nothing. Nothing.
Let's move on to the saving grace.
Do you think
grace.
There are people that love Home on the Range?
I've never heard anyone talk about it.
No, I'm going to again search Twitter for the words love and Home on the Range and see what I find.
Go ahead, Kerr.
Keep going.
I'm going to vamp here. Moving on here to the saving grace of this film, as we said, and it's not even much of a saving grace, it is in the songs. This is the first Alan Menken Disney animated outing since Hercules in 1997. He was attached to the film under the original story and title, and wrote with up-and-coming lyricist Glenn Slater. So, like, I was aghast to hear that Alan Menken was attached to this film, because again, you hear about him in his other hits, you know, Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, but they never ever talk about his work in this film.
And it's actually fine.
Yeah, that little Patch of Heaven song is that recurs throughout the film is probably the strongest.
Yeah, and like the score is pretty good, and he's I wouldn't say he's phoning it in, but someone said they love Home on the Range, and I'm like, no, how dare you? I'm going to now search for Home on the Range underrated. But I think the music in this film, it's not like super memorable, but it's fine.
That Western stuff is hard not to like. It's toe-tapping country music.
Yeah, and like it's uplifting, it's wistful, it gives you that spirit of adventure. You can't go wrong with it.
Menken incorporated well-known classical music pieces into his songs, particularly the yodels. I don't know if you noticed that, Gar. I think I enjoy the songs in this movie. It's the one thing that there is to hold on to, as we said. And interestingly, though, Menken wrote the song Will the Sun Ever Shine Again, probably actually the best song in this movie if you were to take the song in isolation. But he initially wrote it in response to 9/11 and then
put it in his cow film. One of the most devastating attacks on American soil, and like, I'm gonna write this deep soulful song and then put it on like the moment of like no return for my cow film, where the characters, which actually that moment of forced tension is my least favorite part of the film, because it just doesn't feel earned whatsoever, where these characters like break up with each other for just no reason.
Yeah, I'm not even gonna pretend to remember the name of the characters. Judy Dench is like, everything was fine till you came along, we would have turned things around, but like,
she came along literally seconds
before they foreclosed on the farm.
She needs to be taught something about the difference between correlation and causation. Listen, Badonkey Kong, Home on the Range is not the most underrated Disney movie of all time. That is clearly the Great Mouse Detective. Come on.
Gar, there isn't a huge legacy. Well, there is actually quite a big legacy for this film. Home on the Range was the last traditionally animated Disney film released until Princess and the Frog in 2009. And it's said to have been the straw that broke the camel or cow's back, compounding Disney's position that there was no longer interest in traditionally animated features in an era of sophisticated 3D movies. And they decided to go all in on CG animation.
What a weird choice. And I kind of understand it, because obviously Shrek was 3D. And hugely successful.
And Pixar, of course.
And Pixar at the time. But, like, way to blame the medium, you know? That's like 2D animation is like people don't like 2D films anymore. It's like, what nonsense?
Because as you said, there has been films during this time that were, they're not like gigantic hits like they were used to, but they were moneymakers. So, you know,
you just started making films people didn't want and they blamed the medium instead of blaming, like, even like, I get why no one went to see Atlantis. I have no idea who that film is for, even though I think it's actually quite enjoyable. Like, you just made films nobody wanted. Dinosaur? Really? That's your 3D film, by the way.
Now that I think about it, having watched all these in a row, one of the through lines is that all these films were in development for a long time, and they were like, well, it's been there, we may as well throw it out there.
It's Treasure Planet's turn. It's Home on the Range's turn. Like, we've had these ideas for years, we might as well finally do them.
Is there a case for being more discerning and being more Walt Disney-like about it?
Just as we kill know, the project. Yeah. Just kill it. Just move on. Let it go. In the immortal words of the film you made that was a monstrous success... let it go.
Sometimes a project needs to die because...
can't hold it back anymore.
Like, I think just the passage of time and different viewpoints and different creative voices, I think it just becomes very muddled. And just films that had a long kind of troubled production hell, mm-hmm. you know, for want of a better term, but came out okay, you know, it happens, you know.
Like Beauty and the Beast, it wasn't in production forever, but that was a film that was thrown out a year halfway through and made in a year.
You know, Disney did that with The Jungle Book as well. So there are... periods in Disney history where it turned into a triumph, but there's also a case for, like, this has been in development for a long time and it's gone nowhere. Maybe we should just kill it rather than throwing it out there. And they all seem to come at once. So, like, they run out of ideas. So let's just throw all the stuff that's been in the pipeline for a while. So I think maybe that's... I hadn't thought about that before, but I think that's maybe a factor.
And it's the sunk cost fallacy, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like, we've already put all this... And it's literally, you read it earlier, that they tried to do this twice. And instead of just, like, chucking it away, this doesn't work. They're like, how can we repurpose what we've already done?
Chuck a few cows in there.
Yeah, and produce a deeply cynical, churned-out piece of entertainment.
Quick final thoughts, Gar. Don't watch this film.
Don't.
You don't need to. If you're curious, do. It's fine. You're not gonna... It's not a film where you're going to be like clawing your eyes out and wishing that you'd never seen it and it's going to give you nightmares, but it's completely inconsequential. So if you're doing some ironing or doing some doom scrolling, throw it on in the background. Why not? But it's one film, having seen it 1.5 times, that I'm never going to go back to again.
There are too many people that have tweeted the words, Home on the Range is underrated, and it upsets me because it's just a really bad movie.
Kara's going to go on a campaign to give out to every one of them now.
It's no doubt young people who grew up on it, which, like, I'm not one to tell you your nostalgia sucks. But, like, I recognize my nostalgia sucks. Like, we were just talking about Space Jam. That's a bad movie. But it's a great movie. Leave me alone. Same with the Power Rangers movie. Really bad movie. But it's a great movie. Leave me alone. Don't you force your nostalgia on me pretending it's good. Say Hocus Pocus. Not a great movie, but it's a great movie. Leave me alone. Like,
so shouldn't you be more accepting of the kids liking Home on the Range?
No, you see, the difference between here is I am acknowledging these things are bad, but I have nostalgia for them because of time and place and who I was and how pervasive they were in many different forms of culture at the time. If these people were like, I recognize Home on the Range is a really bad movie and such a far cry from the good films Disney has made, but I like it anyway.
Like a guilty pleasure?
I would allow it, but... these people being like, it's underrated. It's not. It's actually probably, it's not, it doesn't have enough scorn. It's like, as a Great Mouse Detective is underrated. Atlantis is underrated. Treasure Planet is underrated. This, bad movie.
All right, partners. We've never...
just wrap it up.
Yes. Well, I got no... Garrett, I think you
better... Let me check my notes, see if we have any other thoughts. More cynical... Oh yeah, I think this is a more cynical version of Emperor's New Groove, actually, because it tries to do a lot of the similar things when it comes to, like, the ironic humor. Like you said, the bounty is the exact same amount as we need to save the farm. Like, Emperor's New Groove had some of that, but Emperor's New Groove was also funnier. But Kronk is in this movie as well.
Yeah, briefly does cameo as a fellow horse to Buck.
Oh, we didn't mention the true sign that this film is bankrupt and has no ideas, is there's the abstract, surreal...
Oh yes. I don't know why I didn't get to that, because that was one of my main notes. It's our first pointless, time-filling, surreal sequence in quite some time.
Yeah, so it's very, very, very clear that, like, the Dumbo, where they slap this, like, surreal sequence into kill 4 minutes of the film and on this already, like, 74-minute film or whatever.
Yeah, and some of that is credits, so it would have been literally 65 minutes without that sequence.
Yeah, so they're just, like, slapping this dopey sequence to fill the time. The forced tension, 3D. Oh, the other thing, I did quite like the idea that the animals at the start have no idea that they're being sold to be eaten. And that's a very bleak thought to think about in a great deal of depth.
Yeah, especially for kids.
Yeah, so it's like these animals being like, but they wouldn't eat us, would they, Mom? And it's like, no. Oh.
And the goat who knows the ways of the world is like, yeah, that's exactly what they're going to do. Except they're not going to eat a goat. But some people might eat a goat.
Mm. Some people eat goat's meat, yeah. But yeah, there we go. I'm out of home in the range thoughts. The film sucks. It's not Disney.
No. I think this is like a, like the other films, you know, it's up and down. It's a bit of a roller coaster, but I think this is a firm indication that they've lost their way.
Mm.
And they wouldn't find it for quite some time again.
They had to buy it back. They had to buy it back. What about next? Go on, tell me while you do the outro.
All right, partners, we've nearly come to the end of the show for another week. Resident musical expert Nicole is coming up in just a few moments with a song from Home on the Range.
By the way, this film is called Home on the Range. And at no point do they do the Home on the Range song. What's the point?
Home on the Range.
What's the point?
Where the deer and the antelope play.
It's like false advertising.
Where it seldom is heard, a discouraging word. And the skies are not cloudy all day. Yeah, that's a missed opportunity.
Why is it called Home on the Range then? Ugh.
Nicole is not going to sing that, but she's
going to... Because it's not in the movie.
And it may be the only saving grace of this week's episode, so be sure to stay tuned for a musical lifeline after the outro. New episodes of Magic by Design drop every Monday, where all magical podcasts are downloaded. Stop by our website at magicbydesign.buzzsprout.com to find a full list of podcast platforms. We are literally everywhere. Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, Amazon Music, that Alexa one, we're on there. We're on YouTube now. Good job, Gar.
Thank you.
You name it, we're on it. We're also active on all your favorite social media platforms. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/magicbydesignpod, on Twitter at magicdesignpod, and on Instagram at magicbydesignpod. If you're liking the vibe of our weekly Disney chats and want to support the show, please do consider giving us a review on your podcast platform of choice. 5 stars, of course. You can also share the podcast on your socials or even recommend the show to a fellow Disney lover. If you don't give us a 5-star review, we will foreclose on your farm. That's sure to apply to at least a few million people, right?
But we'll do it in disguise.
Yes, just as Darkwing Duck.
Mm. Darkwing Duck!
Let's get dangerous. I'm doing a lot of singing this week.
Mm.
Good stuff. We will be back next week at the same time, same place, with a review of Disney's 46th animated feature, Chicken Little, starring Zach Braff. But until then, stay safe and remember, you may think you've seen everything this last year, but you haven't seen everything until you've seen Bovine Bounty Hunters.
Home on the Range is the worst thing that's happened to me.
COVID aside, this is the worst thing to happen in the last year.
Oh.
We promised you a musical treat and the time has come. Nicole is here to stake her claim to Will the Sun Ever Shine Again, the 9/11 song from Home on the Range. Thanks for listening. Now, take us home, Nicole.
Hello there, Disney lovers. It's me, your musical correspondent, Nicole, coming to you live from my bedroom. This week, we're taking it to Home on the Range. Alan Menken returns to write the music for the songs and the score for this movie. After signing a long-term deal with Walt Disney Studios, he's joined by Tony Award-winning lyricist Glenn Slater. Together, they write 6 original songs for the movie, including Yodel, Adel, Edel, Idle, Oo, which incorporates the William Tell Overture, Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, and the 1812 Overture into the Yodel Dance. The music has a distinctive American country feel. Following the September 11th attacks, Menken composed the song Will the Sun Ever Shine Again. The album features performances by artists such as Canadian pop and country singer Katie Lang, voice actor Randy Quaid, blues singer and guitarist Bonnie Raitt, country singer Tim McGaw, and pop rock group The Blue Sisters. This week, the song really resonated with me. Though written in the aftermath of September 11th, it speaks to what we're all going through today during this pandemic. Here's Will the Sun Ever Shine Again. I hope you enjoy it. The sun ever shine again? Feels like it's been years since it started to thunder. Clouds are camping out in the valley and glen. How do you go on when you can't help but wonder? Will the sun ever shine again? What if the rain keeps falling? What if the sky stays gray? What if the wind keeps calling and never go away? Maybe soon the storm will be tired of blowing. Maybe soon it all will be over, amen. How do you go on if there's no way of knowing? Will the sun ever shine? Wish I could say. Send me a sign, one little ray. Lord, if you're listening, how long until then? Will the sun ever shine?